Hello?
So, bale, this will be our first video discussion. So, to start, let us first have an overview of our course. So, our course is income taxation. So, this introductory taxation course is primarily concerned with the basic principles of taxation and income taxation. So, this covers an overview of the national tax system and the income taxation of employees, unincorporated businesses, and incorporated businesses. So this will provide the students with knowledge of the capital gains tax, final tax on passive income, the year-end tax, including the minimum corporate income tax, the normal tax, and the improperly accumulated earnings tax of corporations and withholding taxes. So at the end of the course, so you are all expected to have a working knowledge on income taxation and be able to compute correct amount of taxes and prepare various tax returns required for tax compliance. So the end goal is for your students to know all about income taxation and be able to compute the correct amount of taxes. So ngayon pa lang, ini-inform ko na kayo na ang subject natin will mostly involve computations. Pero don't worry dahil hindi naman kakailanganin. Hindi nyo naman kakailanganin ng superior math skills to pass the subject. Basta tamang application lang ng theories and concepts na pag-aaralan natin dito. So yes, it is a fact na medyo complicated ang taxation system natin dito sa Philippines. But nevertheless, I will make sure na yung discussion natin will be as simple as possible para mas madali lang na maintindihan. So kung babalikan sa lesson 1 na binigay sa inyo via Moodle at naisend rin naman ata sa ating group chat. So sa learning material natin for lesson 1, we have identified doon yung different taxes imposed under the Philippine tax laws. And one of the taxes imposed under the National Internal Revenue Code is the income tax. So again, income tax yung focus natin dito sa subject or sa course natin. So if you can just imagine, sa lahat ng taxes na na-identify natin dyan, isa lang ang pag-aaralan natin in this subject. And yung other taxes na remaining will be learned in your succeeding taxation subjects. So yung ating video discussion in this material will focus on illustrations for compensation income tax. Computation for compensation income tax. But before we proceed sa illustration natin, syempre balikan muna natin yung tinatawag natin na income tax. So ano ba yung income tax? So yung income tax, it is the tax levied on the income from property or an occupation, and it is a direct tax upon the thing called income. Okay? So, simple lang. Income tax yung tawag sa tax na ini-impose or kinokollect from income. So, ano ba yung tinatawag natin na income? Lahat ng income or papasok dito, lahat ng income, mapasweldo mula sa occupation, kita mula sa negosyo, income mula sa property, or income man mula sa investment. So lahat ng na-identify na income na yan will be subjected doon sa tinatawag natin na income tax. And ang mga income na ito ay pwedeng ma-earn ng individuals or corporations. Pero in this lesson or in this material, we will focus on the income taxation of individuals. Okay? So in our lesson 2 learning material na inupload din sa Moodle, so na-identify natin doon yung iba't ibang categories of income. Income which may be earned by individuals. So ano-ano ba yung mga income na yon? We have compensation income, business income, passive income, capital gains tax from sales of shares of stock na traded through the local stock exchange, capital gains from sale of property or real property, and fringe benefits. So in this discussion, I will be providing illustrations for the computation from compensation income. Okay? Or those income which includes all remunerations for services performed by an employee for his employer under unemployee-employer relationship. So madaling salita, ito yung income na nanggagaling sa sahod or benefit, sa lahat ng sahod or benefit ng employees sa pinagtatrabahuan nito. So to start, alamin natin how do we compute for income tax. Okay? Again, emphasize ko lang na yung ating learning material or yung ating discussion will focus on individual compensation income tax. Okay? Income tax computation from compensation of individuals. So I have provided here a simple formula kung paano ba natin makocompute yung tax due or yung tax ng individual from his income from compensation. So yung ating computation will start from the gross compensation. So ano ba yung ating component ng gross compensation, madi-discuss naman natin ito in detail later on sa ating subject, pero ano ba yung generally papasok dito? Siyempre papasok dito yung salary ng employee and other benefits. Okay? So from the gross compensation, i-deduct doon natin yung tinatawag natin na allowable deduction. So later on, i-identify naman natin ano yung papasok dyan sa allowable deductions natin. So after deducting the allowable deduction from the gross compensation, na-arrive na natin yung ating tinatawag na taxable income. So yung taxable income, yun yung income that will be subjected to the corresponding income tax rate na nagagamitin natin in computing for the tax due. So from the taxable income, multiply lang natin yon by the corresponding tax rate and then we will arrive with the tax due. Okay? So suppose na meron tayong example dito, Kayla, who is a single and a resident citizen, meron siyang gross compensation income of 180,000. And this income was earned in the year 2015. So the question is, how much is her taxable income and tax due for year 2015? Given that Kayla is a resident citizen who is single and is allowed basic personal exemption of 50,000 per RA 9504. So in computing for the income tax, it is very important to take note of the following details as they may have implications in the computation of the income tax. So first, na dapat i-note natin yung classification ng individual taxpayer. Kung babalikan yung lesson 2 na file na sinend sa Moodle, so, an individual taxpayer may be a resident citizen, non-resident citizen, resident alien, or non-resident alien. So, yung classification ng taxpayer natin will have implication sa ating computation ng tax. Paano ba yun? So, depending upon doon sa classification ng taxpayer natin, then yung ating it will affect actually yung ating gross compensation portion ng ating computation. Kasi based upon the classification ng taxpayer, then will depend yung ating computation ng gross compensation. Okay? So, ano bang implication? So, given na si Kayla ay isang resident citizen, ano ba yung implication kung siya ay resident citizen? Kapag resident citizen ka kasi, ibig sabihin, taxable yung lahat ng income mo from within the Philippines and without the Philippines. So, all income derived from sources within and without the country will be taxable. While yung case for non-resident citizen, for resident alien, and non-resident alien, taxable lang yung income nila if yung income nila ay nanggaling from sources within the Philippines. So, yun yung implication. Kaya dapat natin i-take note muna yung classification ng taxpayer. So, again, Kayla is a resident citizen. So, ang income niya will be taxable. Lahat ng income niya will be taxable regardless of the source kasi ang resident citizen will be taxable for income within and without the Philippines. Okay? Second to take note ay yung date ng receipt ng income. Okay? So, bakit ba importanteng i-take note natin yung date ng receipt ng income? So, this will have implication as to the computation and the tax rate to be used. Okay? Ang taxation system kasi natin sa Philippines ay constantly changing. And these changes entails changes in the computation method and the tax rate to be used in the computation. So, the latest change in our taxation system is the implementation of the train law or the tax reform for acceleration and inclusion which took effect on January 1, 2018. So, prior to the train law na existing or yun yung implemented na tax law in the Philippines, prior to that, ang pina-follow natin is yung National Internal Revenue Code. Okay? Or yun yung effective na tax law. So, i-differentiate natin yung dalawa. Kung mapapansin nyo, again, prior to 2018, ang tax law implemented is the National Internal Revenue Code. And then, starting from January 2018, nag-took effect yung train law natin. Pero yung first tranche ng train law is will take effect January 2018 to December 31, 2022. And merong second tranche ang train law which will take effect on January 1, 2023 onwards. So, differentiate natin ano ba yung naging changes from NIRC to train law. So, prior to train law, yung taxable income of individuals are subject to the following graduated tax rate. So, pag meron ang individual na income of not over 10,000, take note, this is annualized income, ha? Ibig sabihin, income for the whole year. So, pag merong income for the whole year, ang individual of not more than 10,000, that individual will be subjected to 5% tax rate. Kapag, so meron tayo dito mga tax bracket. And kung saan man siyang tax bracket papasok, then doon siya, then he or she will be subjected to the corresponding tax rate within the bracket. So, differentiate lang natin yung NIRC from the train law. Kung mapapansin nyo, ang naging effect kasi ng train law natin is yung burden ng pagbayad ng tax is nalipat doon sa mas may capacity magbayad ng tax. Kasi yun naman talaga yung purpose ng tax natin. Yung equitable na principle ng ating taxation is yung burden ng pagbayad ng tax is tinatransfer doon sa mas may capacity magbayad ng tax. So, if you will compare yung NIRC sa train law, kung mapapansin nyo, sa train law, na which took effect on January 1, 2018, wala ng tax na babayaran ang lahat ng individual na kumikita ng not more than 250,000 per year. Okay? Unlike nung NIRC, kung titingnan nyo, as low as 10,000 na kinikita ng individual for the whole year will be subjected to tax. Unlike nung train law, na basta hindi sumobra ng 250,000 yung kita mo or yung income mo for the whole year, then you will not be subjected to tax. Ang nangyari dito, mas naging beneficial siya on the part of the low income earner. Kasi nga, kung dati, ang kita mo na not more than 250,000 ay subjected to tax, ngayon, hindi na. So, ibig sabihin, kapag ang income mo for the whole year hindi sumobra ng 250,000, ibig sabihin, wala kang babayaran na tax for the year. So, to continue the table, kung titingnan dito, nag-start yung tax sa train law kapag ang income mo ay sumobra ng 250,000 per year. So, dyan na mag-start yung bracket. 250,000 to 400,000, 400,000 to 800,000, 800,000 to 2 million, 2 million to 8 million, and then over 8 million. So, ang nangyari dito is, nag-start lang yung tax, o magkakaroon ka lang ng tax under the train law kapag ang iyong income ay sumobra ng 250,000. So, yun yung naging difference ng NIRC and train law. So, again, may first tranche ang train law which will take effect or which is effective from January 1, 2018 to December 31, 2022. Pag dumating na ang January 1, 2023, mas magbabago ulit ang tax rate natin. So, kung kanina mapapansin nyo, kapag sumobra ng 250,000 yung income ng isang individual, subjected siya sa 20%. While yung ating second tranche ng train law, which will take effect on January 1, 2023, mas mababa yung tax mo. From 20%, yung income mo, the excess from 250,000 will be subjected na lang to 15% na tax rate. So, ang nangyari dito is mas bumaba yung tax rate for the second tranche. So, another difference nung dalawa, under NIRC, papasok sa allowable deduction yung tinatawag natin na personal exemption. So, ano ba yung tinatawag natin na personal exemption? This includes yung tinatawag natin na basic personal exemption of 50,000 for each individual regardless of status. Ibig sabihin, single ka man, married ka man, divorcee ka man, or hiwalay ka man, you are entitled to a basic personal exemption of 50,000. Automatic na yon. That is under NIRC. And additional doon sa basic personal exemption, pwede ka pang makapag-avail ng additional exemption of 25,000 for each dependent child not exceeding 4 children. So, ano ibig sabihin natin dependent? Ibig sabihin anak or basta dependent na bata sa'yo which is not more than 21 years old, which is the age of majority. Okay? So, yung ating additional exemption, may maximum limit ito na 4 children lang ang pwedeng mong pag-availan ng additional exemption. Ibig sabihin, in maximum, ang pwede mo lang ma-avail na personal exemption is 150,000. 50,000 from basic personal exemption, and then 100,000, which is 25,000 times 4, for the additional exemption. So, since the effectivity ng train law, under the train law kasi, hindi na allowed as deduction from compensation income itong personal exemption. So, under train law, nawala na yung allowable deduction na personal exemption. So, under the train law, basic personal and or additional exemptions are no longer allowed as deductions from compensation income. So, this is the this is another difference of the NIRC and train law. Again, since January 1, 2018, ang tax law implemented in our taxation system is the train law na. Okay? So, going back dun sa ating example, kung titingnan, the income was received year 2015. Okay? Ibig sabihin, anong tax law ang gagamitin natin in the computation of the tax due for kaila? Ibig sabihin, NIRC yung gagamitin natin. Kasi nga, the train law took effect January 1, 2018. So, since 2015, itong tax na kinukompute natin, ang mag-a-apply pa dito is NIRC. And under NIRC, allowed pa si kaila ng basic personal exemption of 50,000. So, how do we compute for the tax due of kaila? Babalikan natin yung ating formula kanina. Tax due is computed from gross compensation deducted by allowable deduction to arrive at the taxable income, environmentally taxable income, multiply natin yung corresponding tax rate for us to arrive sa tax due. So, apply natin yon. So, gross compensation income dito ni Kayla is 180,000. Okay? And under the NIRC tax schedule, tingnan natin yung corresponding tax rate niya. So, ito yung mga bracket ng tax schedule natin under NIRC. So, tingnan natin saan papasok yung gross compensation income ni Kayla after deducting yung basic personal exemption. Again, itong basic personal exemption, ito yung tinatawag natin na allowable deduction. And one of the allowable deduction is the personal exemption, which will include basic personal exemption and additional exemption. So, since si Kayla is single, wala naman siyang dependent child or wala naman siyang dependent na anak sa kanya, so hindi siya pwedeng mag-avail nung additional exemption. Ang pwede niya lang ma-avail is yung automatic na basic personal exemption na available under NIRC. So, meron tayong net taxable income na 130,000. So, ito yung amount ng income that will be taxable and will be multiplied by the corresponding tax rate. So, titingnan natin dito sa tax schedule natin saang bracket papasok yung taxable income ni Kayla. So, 130,000, saan papasok yun? Dito sa bracket ng 70,000 to 40,000. So, ano ba yung income tax rate ng bracket na 70,000 to 140,000? Ang tax rate niya, flat rate na 80,500 plus 20% ng excess ng taxable income sa 70,000. So, ilan ba yung excess ng 130,000 sa 70,000? Yun ay 60,000. So, multiply natin by 20% yung 60,000 na excess ng 130,000 over 70,000, meron tayong 12,000. So, yung total tax due ni Kayla for the year 2015 is 20,500. Again, in the computation of the tax due, start tayo doon sa gross compensation income, which is 180,000, less by the allowable deduction. Ang papasok sa allowable deduction natin, personal exemption, which will include basic personal exemption and additional exemption. In the case of Kayla, ang meron lang sa basic personal exemption. Then, after deducting allowable deduction from gross compensation income, we will arrive at the taxable or the net taxable compensation income. And yung net taxable compensation income, yun yung titingnan natin kung saang bracket siya papasok doon sa schedule or sa NIRC tax schedule. So, doon siya pumasok sa 70,000 to 140,000 na bracket, and ang tax rate doon is 8,500 na flat rate and 20% of the excess of 130,000 over 70,000, which is 60,000, multiplied by 20%, meron tayong total tax due na 20,500. What if yung income ni Kayla or gross compensation income na Kayla na 180,000 was earned in 2019? Okay? Kanina, yung 180,000 na gross compensation ni Kayla is na-earn niya 2015. The reason why NIRC yung tax law that will apply in the computation ng tax due niya. What if naman yung income niya is 180,000 na earn noong 2019? So, how do we compute for the tax due? So, since year 2019, tong receipt ng income ni Kayla, ang papasok na dito na tax law is the train law. Kasi nga, effective January 1, 2018, ang law that will apply or that ang law implemented for the taxation system in the Philippines will be the train law. And under the train law, may differences siya from the previous NIRC. And iba din yung tax schedule niya. So, compute natin yung tax due ni Kayla under train law. Okay? So, again, under the train law kasi, hindi na papasok doon yung allowable deduction na personal exemption. So, sa computation natin, we'll start from the gross compensation income of 180,000 and then wala na tayong personal exemption. Kasi nga hindi na nire-recognize under train law ang personal exemption as allowed deduction from gross compensation income. So from the gross compensation income na 180,000, sa train law kasi, again, mag-start lang yung tax kapag yung net or pagkakapag yung compensation income mo for the year is nag-over sa 250,000. So since ang gross compensation ni Kyla for the year 2019 is 180,000, which is less than 250,000, ang net taxable compensation niya is negative 70,000 or zero. Kasi nga, wala siyang tax for this year or for the year 2019 kasi hindi siya sumobra sa 250,000. Again, under the train law, mag-start lang ang tax kapag yung income mo for the year, which is subject to tax, is more than 250,000, which is 20% yung pinakauna-unang tax. That is the train law that took effect January 1, 2018 to December 31, 2022. Kapag, if ever naman na yung gross compensation ni Kyla is for the year 2023, ito na yung tax table na mag-apply doon sa kanyang tax computation. Okay? So, na-mention natin kanina na under allowable deduction, papasok doon yung personal exemption. Additional sa personal exemption, meron din tayong additional item na pwede pang ipasok sa allowable deduction. Ibig sabihin, pwede pa itong i-minus sa gross compensation income para ang labas ay mas mababa yung magiging taxable income niya. Okay? So, ang ating additional allowable deduction natin, aside from personal exemption, is yung tinatawag natin na premium payments on health and or hospitalization insurance. So, kailan ba pwedeng ma-deduct or ma-deduct as allowable deduction yung ating premium payments on health or hospitalization insurance? So, meron tayong following conditions that must be met for this premium payments on health and or hospitalization insurance be allowed to be deducted as allowable deductions from the gross compensation income. So, ano ba yung conditions natin? First, the insurance shall be taken in the individual taxpayer by the individual taxpayer himself for his family. Okay? So, dapat yung insurance taken for his family. Second, the amount being claimed shall not exceed 2,400 a year or 200 pesos a month per family. Okay? And last, the family has gross income of 250,000 or less for the taxable year. So we have here an illustration for the premium payments on health and or hospitalization insurance. So suppose Brigita, a single mother and is a government employee who earns a monthly gross compensation of 18,000, effective January 1, 2015, she took a hospitalization insurance for her and her 2-year-old son. She right away paid the annual premium of 2,400. However, had she opted to pay this premium monthly, an additional 50 pesos per month is charged. So the question is she entitled to the deduction? If so, how much? So babalikan natin yung conditions natin na dapat ma-met for this premium payments be allowed as deductions. So, ito yung mga conditions natin that must be met. So, isa-isahin natin. First condition. Question, yung first condition na met, na meet ba? Okay? The first condition that the insurance shall be taken by the individual taxpayer himself for his family has been satisfied. Kasi nga, yung insurance ikinuha niya for her 2-year-old son. So, the first condition was met because the insurance was taken for his or for her family. So, yung second condition naman speaks for the annual limit of 2,400 per year or 200 per month. So, the actual premium, so ang ginawa kasi ni Brigita is binayaran niya yung premium for the whole year, which is 2,400. Even though may option na bayaran niya ito monthly, kaso nga lang, magkakaroon ng additional 50 pesos, ibig sabihin, 250 pesos per month yung babayaran niya, which is hindi papasok doon sa threshold na 200 pesos per month. Pero since ang naging actual payment niya is 1 year amounting to 2,400, then this will qualify her to claim the maximum amount of 2,400. So, nasatisfy din yung pangalawang condition. So, if the annual premium were lower than 2,400, the lower amount shall be allowed. So, kapag pinili niya, had she chosen to pay the premium monthly, the total payment would have been 3,000, which is 250 times 12 months. So, if this is the case, then she can only claim for the amount of 2,400, which is again the maximum limit for the allowed deduction from premium payments on health and or hospitalization insurance. So, for the third condition, na-satisfy din ito. Kasi nga, the family's gross income, she being the sole breadwinner, is 216,000. 260,000 kasi yung monthly gross compensation income niya is 18,000 times 12 months to 16,000 per year. And yung condition natin is that yung gross income ng family for the whole year is less than 250,000. Ibig sabihin, since na-satisfy yung tatlong condition na ito, then premium payments on health and or hospitalization insurance ni Brigitta may be deducted from the gross compensation income given that she is a resident citizen or a non-resident citizen and resident alien. So I have here a more detailed computation for compensation under the train law. Okay? So, this is with the assumption that the individual is earning purely compensation income. Okay? So, purely compensation income earners pays income tax computed based on the graduated table on his or her annual taxable income. So, yung mas detailed natin na formula is from the gross compensation income, which is the annual income, less natin yung de minimis benefits, mandatory contributions like SSS, GSIS, Pag-ibig, PhilHealth, and the 13th month or and other benefits with a maximum threshold of 90,000 and other non-taxable income, then we will arrive at the taxable compensation income. So, meron tayong ditong specific example. So, suppose na merong gross compensation income or annual gross compensation income na 400,000 and merong de minimis benefits na 10,000, mandatory contribution na 13,000, 13 month pay and other maximum and other benefits 30,000 and other non taxable income 20,000, totally 93,000. So meron tayong taxable compensation na 307,000. How do we compute for the tax due? Balikan natin yung tax table natin. Again, this is train law because yung ating computation is for the year 2019. So, saan papasok yung 307,000 na income or na taxable income? In our example, dito sa bracket ng 250,000 over 250,000 and but not over 400,000. So, ano yung tax rate nito? 20% of the excess over 250,000. So 307,000 minus 250,000, which is 57,000 times 20%. Then meron tayong 57,000 times 20% is 11,400. So for additional illustration, suppose Fernan is a government employee and has a total income of 50,000 for the year, which includes rice allowance of 1,000, clothing allowance of 5,000, 13th month pay of 45,000, productivity incentive bonus of 20,000, and pera of 5,000. So he paid a monthly mandatory contributions to GSIS amounting to 30,000, PhilHealth 11,000, HDMF 25,000, and he will pay income tax computed as, so he will pay income tax computed as follows. So again, we'll start with the gross compensation income, which is 50,000, deduct natin yung de minimis benefits, mandatory contributions, 13th month pay and other benefits, and the other ng taxable income, and we will arrive at the taxable compensation income. So, how do we compute for the tax due? This is under train law. Tingnan natin yung table. Saan papasok yung 408,000 sa bracket ng over 400,000 to 800,000. The tax due will be a flat rate of 30,000 plus 25% of the excess over 400,000. So, magkano yun? Flat rate of 30,000 plus 8,000 times 25%, which is 2,000, with a total tax due of 32,000. So, under the train law, meron tayong mga items to take note dito. So, first, husband and wife shall compute their individual income tax separately based on their respective taxable income. So, if in case, if any income cannot be definitely attributed to or identified as income exclusively earned or realized by either of the spouses, the same shall be divided equally between the spouses for the purpose of determining their respective taxable income. Next, kapag ikaw ay identified minimum wage earners, then you shall be exempted from payment of income tax. So, this is based on their statutory minimum wage rate. So, correspondingly, the holiday pay, overtime pay, night shift differential pay, and hazard pay received by such earner are likewise exempt. Again, kapag ikaw ay identified as a minimum wage earner, then you shall be exempted from the payment of income tax. So, ano ba yung tinasabi natin na minimum wage earner? Kailan ba masasabi na ikaw ay minimum wage earner? So, the Internal Revenue Regulations 8-2018 defines minimum wage earners as a worker in the private sector who is paid with a minimum wage, statutory minimum wage rate to an employee in the public sector with compensation income of not more than the statutory minimum wage in the non-agricultural sector where the worker or employee is assigned. So, kailan ka masasabi na minimum wage earner? Kapag ikaw ay nasa Region 4 may Maropa B, masasabi na ikaw ay minimum wage earner kapag ang daily wage mo or daily kita mo is 300 pesos or below, which is the minimum wage in Region 4B. So, we have illustrations dito for minimum wage earners. So, Mr. CSO ay minimum wage earners who work for GOD Incorporated. He is not engaged in business nor has any other source of income other than his employment. For the year 2018, nakapag-earn siya ng total compensation income of 135,000. And aside doon, siya ay nag-contribute or may mga mandatory contributions siya to SSS, PhilHealth, and HDMF or Pag-ibig amounting to 5,000 and naka-receive siya ng 13th month pay amounting to 11,000. So, how do we compute for Mr. CSO's tax due? So, Mr. CEO will be exempted from tax. Ibig sabihin, wala siyang babayaran tax given that he is a minimum wage earner. Okay? Next, the following year, Mr. CSO earned aside from his basic wage additional pay of 140,000, which consists of overtime pay, night shift differential, hazard pay, and holiday pay. So, he has the same benefits and contribution. So, meron siyang net taxable income na 250,000. So, how do we compute for the tax due of Mr. CSO? Still, Mr. CSO is exempted from income tax given that he is a minimum wage earner. So, despite na yung kanyang net taxable income nag-exceed sa ating 250,000, which is the magkakaroon ka ng income tax kapag ang total gross compensation income or taxable income for the year is 250,000. So, Mr. CSO is still exempted from income tax kasi nga siya ay minimum wage earner. So, the statutory minimum wage as well as the holiday pay, overtime pay, night shift differential pay, and hazard pay received by Mr. CSO are specifically exempted from income tax under the law.